So I'm a postdoc in Stephen Gough's lab at Columbia University. And so the Gough lab is actually primarily a retrovirus lab. But I want to tell you about a story of some unexpected findings that grew into a whole new project that really led us to some really interesting evolutionary implications. And so first, I want to mention that cancer is not normally contagious. I know there are a lot of infectious diseases that can cause cancers, like HPV, which can cause cervical cancer, feline leukemia viruses that can cause cancer in cats. But in each of those cases, it's the virus, the infectious agent, that jumps from animal to animal, and that causes oncogenic mutations within each new host. Those cancer cells grow within each new host, but they stay there. Now, there were two exceptions to that were known before we started this work. One was in Tasmanian devils, and the other was in dogs, and we'll get back to that in a minute. But first, I want to introduce the model organism, or the first organism we're primarily talking about here, the soft-shell clinoids, or Maya arenaria. And really, we got into this, we are primarily a retrovirus lab, or at least the Gough lab was before this project. But we got into this because of a cancer in soft-shell clams. So there's a fatal leukemia-like amplification of clam hemocytes called hemic neoplasia or disseminated neoplasia. And clam hemocytes, the normal hemocytes are shown here, they're these phagocytotic cells. You can draw the hemolymph out of a clam and put it on a dish. These hemocytes will adhere to the dish quite tightly. You can see the pseudoprotea spread out. But when you look over here, this is what you see when you take hemocytes from a diseased animal. They're rounded, refractile, they don't adhere, a completely different morphology, and they're actually massively amplified within the animal, within the hemolymph itself, and they end up disseminating through all the tissues. And this is actually diluted 1 to 100. When you look at this hemolymph directly, it's just filled with cells, and that leads to the death of the clam. And the incidence actually ranges quite a bit, from 1% in some populations to up to 90%, and that can cause massive die-offs in the population. And so people were seeing these outbreaks of this disease for decades, but it wasn't quite clear what was actually causing it. If the outbreaks were suggesting that there may be some sort of infectious agent, and there's actually a similar disease affecting multiple different bivalves, soft-shell clams, as well as mussels, cockles, and other species. But really, what really got us interested is the description of reverse transcriptase activity that was detected in the tissues of these diseased animals. Now, reverse transcriptase is the hallmark enzyme of retroviruses. And so it had been thought for a long period of time that there was a retrovirus that could be causing this disease, but no one had really been able to isolate, to sequence a retrovirus that could be the actual cause of this. And that's what got our lab interested in. So we did, using high-throughput methods, we looked for anything that resembled a retrovirus. We actually found a retrotransposon instead of a retrovirus. So this has the GAG and the POL, including this reverse transcriptase RT domain. And it's a selfish element that replicates, but stays within a single cell lineage. This doesn't have an envelope, open reading frame. This isn't a virus that can travel from cell to cell. And we knew this was highly expressed in these neoplastic cells. But we then wanted to ask, what is this expression doing? Is it actually increasing the copy number of this transposon within cells? So we looked at the copy number. So here on the y-axis here, we have the RT as a single probe, and then that's normalized to EF1, which is just a single copy number within these cells. In the normal animals, you have about 2 to 10 copies of this element throughout the genome. But when we look at these samples from these leukemic animals, we see a massive amplification. Up to 100, and some of these up to 200, almost 300 copies per haplogenome. So we have a massive amplification of this transposon within these neoplastic cells. And these are samples collected from two completely independent populations. So the same phenomenon is occurring in separate populations here. We then wanted to look at the integration sites of those transposons themselves. And so what I did was use a method of inverse PCR to clone out a small number of these integration sites. We cloned out a dozen of these integration sites from diseased animals and several from normal animals. And what I'm showing you here is a representative sequence from a normal animal and one from a diseased animal in red here. So we have the upstream region, the characteristic 5-base pair repeat, the steamer integration site, and the downstream region. So we designed a primer that's forward, a forward primer in the steamer element here, and a reverse primer in the flanking sequence, you can make a PCR that is diagnostic for a single specific integration site. Now, this one that was identified within a normal individual, we looked at different individuals, we could see that it's present in some, not in others, and it's not correlated with disease. This is just a natural polymorphism, natural polymorphic integration site. But this integration site that was found within the neoplastic cells is not present in any of these blue normal individuals, but it is found in every single cancer cell that we found, in cancer cells from Prince Edward Island and the cancer cells from Maine. And notably, it's present in these individuals. We have samples of hemocyte DNA, so that's the cancer neoplastic cells there. And we also have the solid tissue siphon, so that is not as enriched for the cancer cells, and we see that it's very weakly detected in there. So we know that we have common integration sites in only the cancer cells and not in any normal individuals. So that doesn't really make sense with what we were initially thinking. This is not just de novo amplification of this transposon in each individual, because these integration sites are normally random. And if they were random, we wouldn't see the exact same integration site in every individual. So that led us to consider other hypotheses that could explain what was going on here. And now we have to get into Tasmanian devils. And in particular, the Tasmanian devil facial tumor disease. Tasmanian devil facial tumor disease is a solid tumor that spreads from animal to animal by biting, and it's actually a clonal transmissible cancer that's spreading through the population. And that is, like I said, one of two of these transmissible cancers that were known previously, the Tasmanian devil facial tumor disease and the canine transmissible venereal tumor. This is also a solid tumor that's spread through sexual contact in dog populations, primarily in feral dog populations. And these are actually drastically different in the ages of these. One is about 20 to 25 years old, and the other is estimated to be 10,000 years old or older. So we want to know if this sort of transmissible cancer phenomenon was what we were seeing in the clams. So the first thing I want to show you here is that we used microsatellite alleles to look at the differences between the solid tissues and the hemocyte genotypes. And we look at normal animals. I'm just showing one representative microsatellite allele here. We see one band in homozygotes and two bands in heterozygotes, as you'd expect. When we look at a single individual, when we look at the solid tissue genotype compared to the hemocyte genotype, they match, as you would expect. But we see differences between individuals, but within individuals, we see the same genotype. In contrast, when we looked at these leukemic animals, the solid tissue genotype and the hemocyte genotype were completely different. In every single case, we see a difference between those two in Maine, samples from Maine, Canada, and Long Island. And notably, we see the same neoplasm-associated allele in all of these samples. So that suggested that there's the same allele and the same genotype of that cancer cell that differs from the host. We looked at 10 different microsatellites and built a phylogenetic tree based on the distance matrix. And you can see that the neoplastic cells all cluster in one branch here with slight variation between the Prince Edward Island samples and the Maine samples. But it looks like they are completely separate from all the normal individuals, as well as all of the solid tissue genotypes from the disease individuals that are these open red circles. Additionally, we looked at mitochondrial sequences, and we found a SNP that was present only in these cells and not in any normal samples, and another SNP that was present in this, corroborating this single clonal amplification of a single clonal cancer that's spreading through the population. Now, our model for this is that in the normal individuals, we just have normal clams sitting underneath the sand. They are sessile organisms, so they don't touch each other. But we think that in these neoplastic individuals, these disease individuals, the neoplastic cells will actually spread through the water from one individual to the next, spreading this clonal cancer through the population. Now, I mentioned that there were other species that had related diseases morphologically, and so we wanted to look at some of those to see if the same phenomenon was occurring. So we had contacted some of the collaborators and people working on mussels in Canada, as well as people working on of cockles and golden carpet shell clams in Galicia. And we had a couple main questions. One, were the cancers in these clams transmissible cancers or were traditional cancers? And then if they are transmissible cancers, is this something that is a cross-species transmission from the soft-shell clam lineage we've already identified, or are these new? And so we looked using both nuclear and mitochondrial markers, as I showed before, and what we found was that each of these species has its own independent transmissible cancer lineage. We looked first at the mussels, found the mussels had an M. trostilus-derived cancer that was spreading through that population. When we looked in cockles, we found there were actually two separate independent transmissible cancers that were cockle-derived spreading through that cockle population. And then when we looked at this last sample, and this last species, Polyptatus aureus, we found something a little bit different. Instead of finding slight SNPs and slight variations in the alleles, we found that the sequences of the cancer cells were nearly 10% divergent from the host. And then when we blast these, they're not actually Polyptatus aureus sequences. They're actually Phanerucus porugata. So what we found in this species was that there was actually a cross-species transmission of cancer. The cancer arose within this species, and then jumped and is now spreading through this population here. And notably, these two species actually live in the same ecological habitat. They live together, and no disease has been identified in these. So it looks like the cancer arose from within the species, but now the species is no longer susceptible. So what we see happening is that there is a population sweep that has now made this original population resistant to the spread of disease. So in conclusion, so the STEMR is a retrotransposon that was highly expressed and amplified within the neoplastic hemocytes of the softshell clams. But that, we don't know whether that's causally related to the disease. We know that that was a marker that led us to identify that this was a transmissible cancer cell. So we now know that cancers have been identified multiple times at two mammal species in dogs, Tasmanian devils, four bivalve species so far, and we expect to see more of those. And we also see cross-species transmission in one case, but we also primarily see species-specific restriction. So we know that there are genetic blocks to the transmission of this disease, and it's much more widespread than previously believed. And I just briefly want to mention sort of how we can extend the normal thought thinking about cancer evolution as sort of single initial events and then secondary events which lead to dissemination and metastasis, and how that becomes sort of extended within this system where we have transmission to single individuals and then spread through whole populations. And this is actually only looking at the cancer side. We then have the host population where you have variation within the host, and as this cancer kills the susceptible members of the population, you get development of resistance to these cancers within the population. We have a full-fledged post-packaging interaction here. I want to thank everyone in the lab and all of our collaborators, and I'll see if we have time for a question. Thank you. Mechanism for the spread. These cells can get in the water and then they can filter them in. And they also are invertebrates in that they don't have MHC, so they don't have an adaptive immune system that can have the same self-on-self recognition that vertebrates do. But that said, there's a ton of filter feeders that are invertebrates that live in the ocean. I don't know if this is just something we haven't looked enough to see the other cancers, or whether there's something else that we don't know about. That's a good question.